My name is Gilbert. Thank Pastor for her kind introduction earlier on. I also want to thank the pastors for the opportunity to share God's word today, which is Laity Sunday. Before we proceed, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let's pray. Lord, we pray as we come to hear your word, Lord, open our eyes, open our ears, open our hearts. Let your words of life transform our lives, O Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today is Laity Sunday. Does anyone know the meaning of Laity Sunday? Okay, I see a few nods and a lot of blank looks. Okay, so if we observe over the past few years, Laity Sunday is always a time for someone else other than the pastors to speak. Right, so perhaps we might think that Laity Sunday is a time where the pastors can lay down and take a break. Okay, but no, actually the word laity comes from the Greek word laos. Laos means people. So the laity, which is all of us, we are the people of God, one united people. In the New Testament, the writers cite Hosea, the Old Testament prophet, and God was speaking to Israel through Hosea to say that you were once not a people, but now you have become my people, the people of God. So, as a people of God, let's together read the scripture. Let's join together. Above all, keep loving one another earnestly, since love covers a multitude of sins. Show hospitality to one another without grumbling. As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. Whoever speaks, as one who speaks oracles of God. Whoever serves, as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Let's continue. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you share in Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. Before we take a closer look at the scripture passage, I want to just show these pictures. Anyone knows where these are from? Okay, these are images from modern-day Turkey. Some of you might have been there in person. So you see the famous Hagia Sophia, picturesque mountain ranges, and you can see some vestiges of the ancient Greek and Roman civilizations. Okay, so those who have not been before, keen to visit, sign up at the information counter downstairs. Later on, we're organizing a tour. I'm just kidding. Sorry to disappoint you. Not to make you dream of your next holiday, okay? But why I show these pictures is because this is the area that the recipients of Peter's letter lived. Okay, you can see this on the map. Bear this in mind because this will have implications on how we understand the scripture passage. Let's look a bit more closely at the scripture text. Verse 10 tells us that every one of us, the laity, the people of God, all of us have been equipped to serve. There are no exceptions. Everyone has been given a gift. We cannot say, I cannot serve, or I have no talent to serve. We've had sermon series on spiritual gifts, so I'm not going to repeat those points here. I just want to say that God's grace, it comes in various forms and it's not one size fits all. We often misunderstand. We think that when we talk about having different gifts, it means that we each one go off and do our own thing, kind of like a division of labor, right? Or even worse, it leads to building of our own little kingdoms. But that's not quite what Peter is saying here. So the word in verse 10 that Peter uses for varied, God's varied grace, actually means multicolored, or to use an older term, it means variegated. Okay, and these are some examples of variegated flowers. They are multicolored, they are multi-patterned. The variety actually adds to their beauty and attractiveness. Okay, I just want to add as well that we are not talking about different flowers of different colors and different patterns. It's one flower, but with a glorious blend of tint and hue. So similarly, we are one church, one Laos, one people of God, with a marvelous blend of different gifts. We are equipped for service in ways that are complementary and for one purpose, that in everything, God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. So without exception, we have been given gifts. This also means that we have no excuses not to use them. Age is not an excuse. Position is not an excuse. If we read the rest of 1 Peter, we find that Peter is addressing male and female, slaves and masters, young and old. All have been gifted to serve. All are to be stewards of God's grace. We don't need a title or an official role, whether we are laity, whether we are clergy. We are all God's people called to serve. I just want to point out as well that we are serving God and serving one another. We are not serving the organization. We are not serving the pastors or the leaders. Right? So we can't use an excuse to say, I don't serve because I don't get along with this person, or I don't serve because I don't agree with this policy. There is time and space to resolve these issues, but these are not justifications for us to stop serving. So what does it mean to serve? Peter gives a couple of examples. Firstly, in verse 11, talks about speaking. Okay, and the first thought that will come to our minds is, oh, speaking means giving a sermon. And the second thought that comes to our minds will be, oh, what's for lunch? Because we think that none of us will ever be giving a sermon. But I just want to share a story. So there was once a man who shook hands with the preacher at the end of the service. Right, so he said to the preacher, your sermon was really great, thank you. It reminded me so much of God's peace and of God's mercy. So the preacher was a little bit pleased with himself, lah, because he was someone who only spoke occasionally, like me. Yeah. So he said to the man, thank you. Could you share which part of the sermon was it that really touched you? So the man replied, oh, the sermon reminded me of God's peace because it surpassed all understanding. And it reminded me of God's mercy because it endured forever. But the reality is our words can bring God's peace and God's mercy, even if we never speak from the pulpit. We all have opportunities to speak God's words all the time. Question is whether we will seize those opportunities. So I think of Sunday school teachers, right? I think of my own Sunday school teachers whose words have impacted me and who have shaped and helped to mold me, right? I want to acknowledge, in the first service, I acknowledged some of them, people like King Ho, Mui Ling, Han Tiong, Wei Shun, Gibson, Sarah, who is now in Indonesia. I just wanted to say that, you know, your words, your speaking have helped to shape me. And I just want to say thank you. I just wanted to affirm that service. How about in our PCGs? In our PCGs, our words can bring perspective, can bring hope, can bring encouragement to our friends. And it's not just the PCG's leaders' words that matter. All the members' words matter too. So my wife and I lead a PCG, and it brings us great joy when we see our own members speaking, ministering, and encouraging to one another. We just sit there and watch. How about mentors? The youth and the young adults have been looking for adults who are willing to share their stories, share their experiences. So perhaps if you have these stories and experiences, as a young but not so young adult, it's something that you can also be speaking life to the younger ones in our church. But of course, speaking is not limited to just a church setting. How about in the marketplace? Our words could bring support to a colleague who is having a tough time. Our words could bring courage to a colleague who is struggling whether to cut corners, whether to do the right thing. At home, our words can be a foundation for our children, a strength to our spouse. So wherever we have opportunities to speak, let's ask God to speak His words through us. Another example that Peter cites, hospitality in verse 9. When we think of hospitality, we think of hosting a friend to a meal, bringing them to Orchard Road, some of the tourist destinations. Maybe it's about welcoming new people, newcomers to our church. And we saw earlier today our hospitality team decked out in their new attire. So yes, that's part of the idea. But Peter's audience had a slightly different understanding of what hospitality meant. So imagine with me, let's go back again to Peter's time. Okay, so Peter's audience lived in a region that was crisscrossed by quite a number of Roman main roads. Right, so this meant they received frequent travelers passing through the region. Some of them were traders, some of them were itinerant preachers. But there were no five-star hotels during that time. No Hilton, no Marriott. There were four seasons. It's called winter, spring, summer, and fall. What they had was inns, right? So places that were quite shabby, somewhat dangerous, filled with lice and vice. So what does hospitality mean for the early Christians to Peter's audience? It meant welcoming strangers into their homes, providing food, providing shelter and safety without payment. And we know that many Christians at that time were poor. So showing hospitality would come at a cost, a monetary cost, and also the cost of disruption to their everyday lives and schedules. Probably some of them were complaining, "Ayah, how come there are so many people passing by this time of the year, always want to come to our house?" You can imagine them saying that, maybe not in Singlish lah. But regardless, Peter instructs his first hearers to show hospitality without complaining. How can we show hospitality today? Okay, so in my day job, I work for the government. I do population policy and research. And this chart is something that my colleagues and I helped to publish quite recently. Okay, if you look at the pie chart, if you look at the numbers, it shows that about a third of Singapore's population are actually here on short-term stays, the non-residents. The pie chart shows the breakdown. We have international students, employment pass holders, work pass holders, foreign domestic workers, and so on. In fact, a number of you in this congregation yourselves will be here on one of these short-term passes. So I'm not saying that as Singaporeans we need to welcome 1.6 million people into our houses, but what we can do is to move out of our comfort zones, to welcome and show care towards the newcomers in Singapore. Just now, Mrs. Shalon mentioned the dinner that we hosted for some of the construction workers who were building the performing arts facility. And that's great. But apart from construction workers, how about the internationals whom we cross paths with more frequently on a day-to-day basis? Perhaps we could do something simple like invite a non-Singaporean colleague out for lunch. Perhaps invite an international student to join our small group meetings. Just simple gestures, but no gesture, I think, is too small. At this point, I want to acknowledge as well that hospitality, that service is not always easy. So let's look at Peter's letter again. He says, "Don't be surprised that trials are part and parcel of the Christian's life experience. There's nothing strange about it. It's not a matter of if trials come, but when trials come." Right? And Peter is not talking about trials like sitting for exam or having an interview with your boss. He's talking about Christians facing social ostracism and and exclusion. What do I mean? Let's come back again to the historical context of the letter. During the early days of the church, Christians were accused of several crimes. Incest, cannibalism, and atheism. Well, very extreme, right? How did this come about? Incest, because Christians made it a point to love all their brothers and sisters, right? And this was misunderstood by the general population. How about cannibalism? Well, every week they would gather to eat someone's flesh and drink someone's blood, right? Atheism, because they rejected the host of gods in the Roman pantheon and decided to worship a crucified criminal. So you can imagine that Peter's audience faced social ridicule and rejection from their neighbors. Yet despite these false accusations, misunderstandings, and even mockery, they continued to love and serve one another. They continued to show hospitality. They continued to care for the sick, the poor, and the widows. Living a life of service was costly for the early Christians, and it can be costly for us today. When we try to show hospitality, we may get rejected, we may get turned down, we may get weird looks from our colleagues who don't like foreigners. When we serve God in various ways, in variegated ways, we may be misunderstood. No doubt there will be some who affirm our service and our work, but there will also be those who criticize, who say that we're just wasting our time. Some of those whom we try to serve may even turn around and try to take advantage of us. But Peter reminds us that in times of difficulty and suffering, we can persevere in service. How do we sustain this in the long run? How do we persevere in the face of opposition? Ultimately, I think it comes down to our motivation for serving. One motivation for service is a sense of duty and responsibility. We recognize God's call to be stewards, to fulfill the responsibilities that God has entrusted to us. But there are also dedicated stewards who serve well, but with the wrong motives. A lot of the Rings fans would recognize this guy. Boromir, son of Denethor, the son of the steward of Gondor. He was dedicated and committed to his role, even heroic in his service. But he was undone by his mixed motives. Now, please don't get me wrong. I want to affirm that duty and responsibility are crucial in service. But the question is, what is the motivation that undergirds our desire to be a good steward? Another possible motivation, compassion and pity. Perhaps we have come to be aware of an important need. Perhaps we have heard a moving or inspirational story. Or we are moved to action by a sense of injustice. It's important that we serve with passion and compassion, not mechanically out of a sense of obligation. But there's also such a thing as compassion fatigue. So to be sustainable, service must go beyond compassion. I would humbly suggest that besides duty and compassion, there's a frequently overlooked motivation for service, and that is gratitude. Gratitude, because service is not something we do to earn favor with God. Gratitude, because we are not the heroes to fix the problems that we see in the world. Many of us serve because we want to make a difference, and that's not wrong. But we easily slip into thinking that we are the solution. No, true service, I believe, recognizes that we are not the hero, but God is. We are messed up people who have been rescued by a gracious God. As the saying goes, we are like beggars telling other beggars where to find bread. Peter, who wrote this letter, he thought he was better than the other disciples. He thought he would be the one to die for Jesus. In the end, he denied and abandoned his master. But his master did not abandon him. Like Peter, we too are broken people. broken people who have failed God. Like Peter, we are the undeserving recipients of God's unconditional grace. Like Peter, our service arises as a grateful response to God's great love. We love because He first loved us. And having received so much from God, our response can only be to love and worship and serve Him. Our desire must be to see God's name magnified and glorified. So whether it's in social action and community outreach, or providing mutual care and support in our small groups, whether it's helping to nurture the next generation, or just being an encouragement to our colleagues, let us all serve out of gratitude. Let us all serve in God's strength, so that in everything, God may be glorified. I just want to conclude by drawing our thoughts and our eyes to the communion table. Today we remember God's love for us, Holy Communion. Remember His body broken, His blood poured out for us and for many. We come with gratitude because we did nothing to deserve the good gift of His Son. We come and eat with thankfulness because God has given us gifts to share with His people. He has equipped us. He has given us the privilege to serve. We rise with joyful hearts to love one another earnestly, to show hospitality and to serve joyfully, so that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Let it be our prayer that wherever God has placed us, we will offer up our lives, our blood, sweat and tears to serve Him by serving others. Let us serve as God's Laos, the one people of God. Amen.